This afternoon is Misha Chertkov talking about gauge transforms and graphical models.
Thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. And so it's a joint work with Volodya Chernyak and Yura Maximov, who is in the audience. This work has some prehistory, and we started playing with gauges and loops for graphical models, and specifically partition functions, with Volodya, in 2005, 2004. But most recently, and when I visited EPFL, I basically learned and through that about polynomials and mix of those two subjects is more or less what this talk is about. So it's inspired by a lot of stories which this community produced. I'll touch on that, and you'll see quite a lot of polynomials, but actual results in relation to stable polynomials in particular will be in the very end, and more or less those are not new results, but just to a degree reinterpretation of what this community already produced. Well, I hope you'll see something new and maybe useful in particular for you. So my plan is here is a schematic diagram. I don't know if you can see what I drawn in here. So that's a kind of set of subjects which I'll cover. So I'll start by introducing graphical model, and it will be rather general graphical model. Even though, of course, examples like perfect matchings and Ising models I've mentioned many times, so I'll illustrate it in perfect matchings, actually. And then will be this gauge transformation, which is in the center of what I'll be presenting. In 2006, with Oleg Chernyak, we went into this path, which we call loop calculus or loop series. But this new story, which appears in conjunction with polynomials, is more or less a reinterpretation of what Gurwitz introduced in this field, and what I actually probably first time heard when Leonie was at Los Alamos. I also was at Los Alamos, still is. But then I didn't really catch it, so you'll see how it plays together. So it will be a quite extensive introduction in what graphical model is, and that will be from a perspective of what we've been doing through so-called belief propagation, beta free energy approach, and then how we go beyond what is approximate algorithm message passing or belief propagation to what sometimes we call belief propagation. Beyond belief propagation. So some exact statements about partition function will be made. Okay, so now it's actually for construction which I'll be discussing today. I'll want to work with of course it will be multivariate, and in the story which I'll be presenting, my graphical model will be with variables which reside on edges, and some of the stories which are behind this talk extendable to alphabet and even continuous, but I'll restrict myself to binary. So now I also will be using multi edges, allow self edges as well, because of some graph reduction construction which I'll be discussing. But otherwise it is more or less one of possible representations of what we call graphical models. Sometimes we call this type of representation Forney style graphical model after David Forney. So the only really not very standard thing is the introduction of this multiple edges or self loops, but that's not very significant in terms of generalizing of what we use as a definition. And then the focus, of course, is, as in many other talks, partition function. So now I'll be focusing on partition function. Of course, we heard already many times that that's useful because we can compute marginal probabilities. And of course, we can do sampling, but focus will be on partition function. So now there are some stories which I'll not be touching, which in my extended team we've been we spend quite a lot of time, and that's kind of inverse problem, not inference, but learning. So I'll not be mentioning it, but just wanted to put it. And kind of on a high level, many of those problems for me coming from kind of applied math and physics related to those two applications, so engineer systems and fluid mechanics, but I'll not be discussing that at all. Well, if you're interested, we can chat offline about how it all applies in those applications. Okay, so I'll start. In fact, you already heard about that from Nishit, but he presented it in a little bit different way. I'll basically walk you to beta free energy. So that's the first pass which I'll follow. It basically starts from this statement of a problem of counting, which is computing weighted counting, computing partition function as an optimization problem. And it of course depends on if you're coming from physics background or maybe computer science background. You can call it Gibbs or Gibbs-Kubelik-Leibler, but that's what it is. So you introduce, you go from discrete space. So I'm talking about binary variables again, residing on edges and functions or factors, the residing on vertices, on nodes. So now I go into space of beliefs. And as you remember, probably Nishit actually made quite, he spent quite a lot of time describing, how nice it is, but also why it is restrictive. Because of phase space you are going into is exponential. But by and large, what I'm doing, I'm going from discrete to continuous, and I start to walk in a space of probabilities. So for each state, I introduce probabilities, and then introduce this very large polytope. Formally speaking, that's a nice convex, or in this case, actually concave optimization. So now, what we learned through Edidia, Freeman, and Weiss paper, which is done in 2005, but frankly, I don't know and don't understand why. If beta would be asking this question in the 30s, algorithmic type of questions, probably it would be possible to come up with this type of scheme right then. So basically, the idea is it's all started from trees, and that's of course certain reincarnation of dynamic programming. In the case of a tree, you can write joint probability distribution in a factorized form. You can express it through marginals, and for this specific graphical model, I introduced two types of marginals. That's a belief associated with node and belief associated with edge. And so it's not mean field, which would be product of independent probabilities, marginal probabilities, but it's a ratio. And meaning of this, what you have in a downstairs, is that you just overcount the number of edges. Each edge contributes to two nodes. And so therefore, you basically need to compensate for that. And that's what it is. So it's exact formula if you're on a tree. And of course, those are expressions for marginal probabilities. So now what he did, Freeman and Weiss did, and it was very empirical. They said, OK, let's substitute it in this Gibbs-Kubelik-Leibler see what happens. So it was just, of course, exact on the tree, but in general, absolutely no guarantees in terms of if it will give low bound or upper bound, and that's really the case in general. In a graphical model world, what you're getting beta-free energy, which is tractable in the sense that it is finite dimensional, but it's not necessarily convex, or concave for that matter, and that's what it is. It's not necessarily low bound to upper bound. So now one thing to mention is that, of course, between those two type of beliefs, which are associated with nodes and edges, they're related to each other. And when you start thinking in terms of this space of beliefs associated with nodes and edges, you form this polytope. And so that's already a tractable polytope, tractable in terms of number of constraints. And that's actually for many analytic things which we draw from this analysis, that was quite useful. So that's what we call beta free energy. And this term actually was coined by Edidi Freeman Weiss. Jonathan Edidi is physicist by training. By the way, Hans Bethe was still alive when it was introduced. And I wonder if he reflected on this name. I don't know. Okay, so now, well, in this community, and we already heard it from Nishit, so there were those two papers which more or less took this beta free energy and more or less for almost for formulation, for graphical model which I presented, well, they didn't introduce this self edges and multiple edges, but generalization is kind of trivial. So they more or less come up with this optimization, which is a dual version of what I showed in the previous slide. So basically all those constraints which are between beliefs associated with nodes and associated with edges, you introduce Lagrangian multipliers, and those are logarithm of those, well, you introduce logarithm of x as a Lagrangian multiplier, and this is this polynomial structure which you are getting. So now we are getting closer to those polynomials. So now, so you introduce x's, but you also keep those beliefs which are associated with edges. Since it is binary, there is one belief which you can fix, another you can express probability of having zero, probability of having one. So beta is probability of having one. And this is generalization of what Leonie suggested in his 2011 paper for perfect matchings. And so that's a little bit of prehistory of this beta free energy and now connection to the world of polynomials. This example of perfect matching, so I'll be kind of it just illustration. I'll keep it rather general for any graphical model of the type I introduce. So now what is there is some special thing about these graphical models, and it's actually emphasized maybe tendency in this graphical model research. There are, well, to make general statements quite difficult, so we often narrow down to some specific cases, like in this case, perfect matching, maybe matchings. And then good things happen. In particular, in this case, convexity of this beta free energy approach restored, and that's what Pascal Vantabel showed in 2010. Well, on the other hand, you also get some very strange situation, even though you, at high enough temperature, when those mu's are sufficiently large, you actually intuitively don't expect to be on a boundary of polytope, but you can get to the boundary of polytope. So, there are concrete cases when we can show that. And another, well, so that's already specifics. And another, very important statement made by Leonie in this 2011 paper, you can show this beta free energy is low bound for actual partition function. So I'll come back to that in a little bit more general setting later on. But what will also be important for what I'll be discussing is to actually avoid the situation that I'm on the boundary. And it's actually relatively simple to do. Well, on this particular example, what you need to do, you need to, shift your, so basically you need to prohibit any states in your model to have zero probability. Well, in perfect matching, formally, of course, you have those states, right? You need to color only one edge. But if you introduce even very small epsilon, that's sufficient for pushing you from boundary to interior, and that's relatively easy to prove for this kind of graphical models. And that's what I'll be using. I'll always be assuming that I'm an interior. So my beta free energy solution, so minimization of beta free energy, gives me solution in the interior of polytope. Okay, so now that's what I stated in here. That's what I covered. So I went from graphical model to beta free energy, and I don't know if you can see. You probably cannot, because I cannot. So I mentioned that it's polynomial representation of beta free energy. But let me now take a completely different approach, I'll now go to these gauges And first gauge transformations, explain what is that, then it will be some graphical transformations, but I'll connect back to belief propagation through this other path. Okay, so what is gauge transformation? And so that's what we introduced with Volodya in 2006, but what was mentioned already in this workshop is that it's quite similar and very much related to holographic transformation, which Valent used in a very restricted format for planar graphs, and it was this match gate, so it's only for perfect matchings, or for matchings, but it's really the same type of tool. It's also very much related to what Martin van Wright, when he was still a student at MIT, called reparametrization. So main idea is you start gauging, so that's why we call it gauge, your factors. So you have these Fs, which are associated with nodes, And those are some functions, positive and non-negative. Well, in my case, it will be always positive. I don't want any state to have a zero probability. I can pose the following question. How can I change it so that partition functions stay invariant? And apparently, there is a rather big class of transformation. In this case, I specifically interested for... I'm looking for multilinear transformations, and that's formally written down in here. And a requirement for me is I want to study class of these transformations which we keep partition function invariant. And in the case of binary variables, and again, my variables are on edges, you should think of it as introducing, that's a complete description of this family of multilinear transformations which can preserve a partition function. You basically need to introduce two by two matrices, make them orthogonal to each other at each edge. Well, and I call them JB, JBA. And that's about it. So that's the only constraint which you need to have to keep invariance of partition function. It's very straightforward to check. It's very simple algebraic transformation. So now let's see what it buys us. I'll get to some of those benefits which you are getting through this transformation, but first I wanted to connect back to polynomials. And so now I want to talk in terms of specific reparametrization of this 2x2 matrix. And out of those four terms which I have in 2x2 matrix, actually only two are relevant, others are kind of degrees of freedom which more or less I can get rid of by trivial rescaling. So I introduce those two variables and I make them positive and will be two on each edge. And that's a very concrete, very specific form of one of those matrices G which I introduce on edge, and this form preserves this orthogonality. If I go from G associated with one direction, which I go through this edge, and G associated with another, that's how I introduce those two Gs. That's a specific form which I pick. And the following statement can be more or less algebraically and straightforwardly proven. That if you pick extremum, and actually my beta free energy might have multiple extremums. So this extremum of beta free energy corresponds to stationary point of this specific structure which I'm getting, and a specific function which I call gauge function. And this function originates from the following. So I went from my original factors to these new factors, right? And I have this new degrees of freedom, G or X, in here. And which basically led to redistribution of weights between different terms in my partition function is still a sum of a states, right? But I redistribute weights so that in sum partition function is the same, sum is the same. So then what I'm doing, I'm picking first term in this sum. And it actually doesn't matter which term I pick. And I call this term gauge function. And it does depend on this axis which I introduced before. So it will change when I change those gauges, those axes. And now what I'm telling you is that beta free energy, which belief propagation, this solution fixed point of this beta free energy which I introduced before, or rather you did a Freeman Weiss introduced before, like correspond to stationary points of this function. And if I actually pick if I pick a fixed point which gives me the largest contribution to this gauge function, that will correspond to minimum of beta free energy in this optimization which I showed before, this beta free energy optimization. So that's interesting observation. Well, this observation has more or less from all some while ago, but a consequence of this observation, which I just wanted to mention, I'll not be following on that much in the rest of the talk, is what we call loop series. So basically, when you pick this particular gauge according to this beta free energy, to this fixed point of gauge function corresponding to beta free energy, so I call it BP, belief propagation, or beta piles, and then what I'm getting is this sum. I'm getting that many terms are actually zero. And specifically, if I would have a tree, then all terms but first will be zero. And that's exactly this dynamic programming thing. And we call it loop series because contributions which are left, they're generalized loops. So they're shown for this particular example. So basically, you don't have this any node which is degree one in your coloring of edges. And that's, well, formal definition of what we call generalized loops. And each term, remaining term in a series, have a specific expression which depends on this beta free on belief propagation solution, which is a fixed point of this gauge function, which you can find explicitly if you know this solution already. And unfortunately, or maybe fortunately, those terms are not necessarily all positive. So there may be some terms which are negative. And that's, on one hand, complication. On the other hand, that's the nature of the beast. In some cases, very good cases and very special cases, we are getting that all terms are positive, but it's not necessarily true in general. OK, so I'm not going. So there were quite some stories which we played algorithmically from 2006 till, well, more or less last year. So we play with minimum weight perfect matching. So there are some stories. We also, you may reinterpret this loop series. Well, loop series is, you can think of it as a new graphical model. You went from one graphical model to another graphical model. Of course, you lose, if some terms are negative, you lose this probabilistic interpretation. But formally, algebraically, it is, well, you can think of it as a kind of strange graphical model with weights which are possibly negative. So you can actually think in particular about sampling them. And in some cases, we succeeded. And that's in collaboration with Jinwoo Shin from KAIST and his team. We succeeded to show that it's actually nice. You can sample efficiently. So it's a kind of combination of this belief propagation, beta free energy with sampling. We also explored various ways of how to mix this belief propagation with mean field, which is another kind of variational approach. But let me not go into that. So I want to connect now in a new way to what we heard here at this workshop before, this polynomial connection. And now it probably will become clear why I introduce those self edges, or multiple edges, and self edges. So more or less, I'll start by this very simple construction, which is yet not related to polynomials at all. So I'll pick my graphical model, and I start, let's say, with this graphical model, which doesn't have any self edges or self loops. And I'm interested in computing partition function, how I can do it. I can eliminate edges, right? I can basically sum over all variables in this case, sum with respect to this variable. So that's what I'm showing in here. So you transition from this graphical model to that graphical model. And you keep doing it. Of course, you formally can do it, but complexity of your degree in your reduced models will increase. But formally, that's what I call graph reduction. So you eliminate edges. And of course, it's kind of trivial to check that partition functions always will be more or less, will conserved, or will be conserved through these graphical transformations. So now, connection to what Lenya suggested in the context of perfect matching, and now Nima and Nishit, so those two papers, more or less explored in a little bit more in a more general way, more or less in the context which I'm exploring in here. So you can now, and now I'm connecting to my object, which I call gauge function, right? And introduce, you remember, I introduced this gauge function, it was the ratio of those two polynomials. An axis were my gauge variables, and I have two axes per edge. So now what I can do, I can introduce this strangely looking differential operator, one plus differentiation over those two variables associated with particular edge, and then I'll be marginalizing. Right, so I'll be putting those. I'll apply this operator to, to partition function or something which will be left at every step from partition function, and then I'll be zeroing those variables. And the statement is, which is very straightforward to check, it's just explicit kind of algebraic construction that I start from my gauge function and I end up with partition function. Okay, so that's. That's very straightforward and exact transformation. So now let's see, so I call it differentiator and marginalized, but very algebraic and very straightforward to check. Well, simple to check in a case when I'm in the interior of polytop. When I'm on the boundary, I may have troubles with differentiating, and that's why I move myself to interior. Okay, so now, so that's basically, I already said that. So this algebraic transformation, which I showed on the previous slide, and this graph transformation, they more or less give the equivalent. But now, I'll be connecting to belief propagation. And that's something extra and actually as important. And it will lead me to this lower bounds, which well, Lenya suggested for perfect matching, and then Nima and Nishit in those two separate papers showed in more or less for this type of graphical models which I'm discussing. So now, instead of doing this algebraic transformation which I showed you before, I'll be basically, I return back to my definition of beta free energy. And beta free energy, it's a, there are multiple extremum potentially. I can pick one which maximizes at Z, and that's most reasonable. So, but definition of this extremum is basically in here. So very straightforward, right? It's a fixed point of this gauge function. But now let me start doing something equivalent to this edge elimination, but one by one. Applying this now differentiation, much simpler operation, but to more or less the same object. So it's another construction, right? It's different from this explicit algebraic construction, which exact algebraic construction, which I show. But let's study what it will give us. And so I eliminate single edge. And more or less, in this case, what I care, I represent this polynomial in this, it's multilinear, so I obviously can represent it in this form. In the case of binary alphabets, that's what I can do, right? Constant, linear, and this bilinear. And then I more or less applied my differentiation operation to this object. I'm getting more or less quadratic equation to resolve, which so far doesn't look very promising, right? I mean, it's, now already not polynomial expression. But in fact, if I'll start contracting edges, which are not self edges, but really normal edges, then I'm getting to polynomial structure gain result of the differentiation. And more or less what is straightforward to check is that this BP transformation, I call it BP graph transformation, so its application of the differentiation is exact, but for normal edge. And that's what I state in here. An immediate corollary of that is that I can go from this big graph to what we were calling bouquet, right? So basically, I'm not allowed to contract, basically do what I'm doing here, to contract self edges. But I'm contracting normal edges. So BP is exact in this case. So that's a generic statement. I'm not using so far anything special about this polynomial. It's just algebraic construction. Okay? And in general, for any of these graphs, I can study what I've been calling beta free energy, right? So I reduce, I contract H, and in principle, I can try to solve, minimize this beta free energy and try to find a minimum of beta free energy. And I'm getting the sequence of, let me not call it approximations, some estimations for this beta free energy estimations for partition function. And in general, they are not monotonic, so they are kind of ugly. And complexity, of course, increases with contraction. So far, it's not clear how to use it. But in principle, it's also give me some procedure, which if I'm lucky and if I'll start using some good properties of polynomial, may lead me to something, better than just those general and kind of empty statements. And in principle, I can stop this procedure at some moment when complexity of my degree is not yet too large. That's maybe useful in the future. We are not yet using that, but it certainly sounds promising to me. Okay, so far what I've been discussing, so that's a little piece which is left, which I want to tell you, and that more or less will be now in my terms, reproduction of what you already heard from Nishit. I'm now coming to the statements about bistability. So basically I'll be assuming some specific properties of my graphical models and my polynomials which are behind graphical models. That's what I have left for remaining 12 minutes. Okay, so now I want to compare this BP with exact. In exact, I have this elimination with this operator, which was 1 plus and 2 differentiation. And in BP world, it was just differentiation. So now, what can be very straightforwardly deduced from this structure of my belief propagation elimination is this statement that if So basically, what I have on the left is this elementary structure which I am getting in the result of belief propagation procedure, algebraic procedure. And on the right is what I'm getting from exact. So now, if I want my belief propagation to be low bound, then that's what I need to, more or less, it's straightforward to check that if I want my belief propagation to be smaller, estimation of coming from belief propagation for partition function at every step to be smaller, then what I need to require. And equivalent statement, which was made in those two papers, it's practically the same, but now they had it in an optimization way as opposed to differential way, which I presented in here. So it's, a little difference, but those statements, when I'm in theory of polytope, they're absolutely equivalent. Okay, so now if I introduce bistability, and, it's actually, as I learned from Nima, it doesn't need to be for bipartite graph, so bistability may be kind of more general, but it's probably natural to start from bipartite graph. And by the way, one way to get bistability in start from bipartite graph and do this elimination, which I was more or less discussing. But in this case, what you're getting indeed the low bound estimations. A little extra, which I'm getting from my procedure, but I guess it was just not emphasized in those two early papers. In principle, I'm getting not only that my belief propagation for my original graphical model is a low bound, but I'm getting that it's all the whole sequence of this belief propagation is monotonic. And that may be also useful in terms of approximation and truncation. So that's what we are getting through adding this specific structure, which is real stability or bistability. So that's the same statement which I already made. So now, again, reference to getting from this world of real stability or bistability statement that belief propagation estimation is a low bound, and again, first made by Lerner for permanence, and then generalized for this Forni-style graphical models. I also wanted to mention, I think it was discussed before, there are quite a number of other statements, not a lot, but some, which allows to estimate, basically similar statement, when belief propagation for specific graphical models is a low bound. And specifically for attractive ferromagnetizing model. It's only for attractive, for ferromagnetic. In fact, I think Lerner was asking this statement, I think when Peter was talking about loop series, and Lerner was asking if from loop series we can get any low bound estimation. When you require that those terms are all positive, of course you're getting low bound because you believe propagation is the first term. But even in this case of attractive ferromagneticizing model, it's not a generic statement. So you need to have additional constraints, and that actually was suggested and discussed in this paper of Sanders, Van Wright, and Bilski. Right, so it's not yet clear to me if there is any way to prove it through this polynomial world. And it's actually quite interesting, I think, to connect. And it's another type of graphical models. But maybe there is some connection. Maybe it can be done through polynomials. Okay, so I'm more or less done with what I wanted to accomplish. So I went from graphical models. I first told you about beta free energy. Well, introduced polynomial representation. Then got to gauge transformations. Well, discuss a little bit loop series, which is kind of to a degree open-ended. There are some applications, but not a lot. And then went through this loop of graph reduction. So what is really methodologically very important for me is that we've been kind of stuck with this gauge transformation. We didn't think about graph transformations. And now I'm more or less getting this additional tool of combining. So I may reduce my graph, and I may gauge my factor functions, and there is probably something interesting which can be extracted from this mix. I put some of those possible directions for us to explore, but there are probably many other. So I already mentioned that it would be. So this partition, this gauge function, allows me to, this gauge function give me two passes to exact. So one pass through this loop series and completely different pass through this, differentiate and marginalize, so new for me. And so they both connect through belief propagation, but how to use them together, still open question. So I think I keep asking probably many of you folks about generalizations to high alphabets. We believe that it's possible, and we don't know what kind of polynomial properties will allow us to do low bound or some statements, but it's actually another very, very cool direction for us to explore. We, of course, want tighter approximations, and so this loop series, I can sum those terms. If I'm creative, of course, there are exponentially many. I cannot sum all of them. But if I have a smart way of selecting and maybe sampling, that's what we already start to explore. This graph reduction gives me another degree of freedom. And maybe if I do smartly combination of the two, so maybe I can come up with a better and tighter approximations. This bistability is a global property, right? So it's maybe I don't need this. Well, maybe I can live with absence of zeros only in a much smaller part of a phase space, right? And how to define this class of polynomials, I don't know. You probably, well, you certainly know it better, but that's what we, at least empirically, that's what I certainly want to play with, and maybe there are some theories behind, I mean, possible. And the sequential elimination is actually connects to quite a body of work which is done on a graphical model site empirically. This type of work you can find actually quite a lot 10 years ago in NIPS or ACML. Even today there are quite a number of papers, and I don't know, you probably heard about this mini bucket elimination. So basically idea of elimination of variables, but doing it not necessarily exactly but approximately at certain moment, because if you do it exactly, you more or less complexity grows. And by the way, it also connects to what we heard from previous talk, this tensor type of decompositions as a model reduction they're used here. So I don't know where it will lead us, but that's an interesting connection, which probably, I don't know if in this community you guys discuss that. And so with that, I'm done. Thank you.
Questions? Remarks, philosophies.
By the way, is there any like interesting upper bound? So now there is this my conjecture that root of 2 to the power n was proved. But is there some kind of maybe heuristics to get from all this stuff? Root of 2n, can you get it maybe not rigorously, but...
Well, the only paper I know which claims in the graphical model community upper bounds, it's Andrzej Ristetsky. He's at MIT, and it's relatively recent, and otherwise, I don't know.
What did you get? What was this upper bound thing you were telling us about?
For graphical models in general, so it was...
When specialized to, let's say, perfect permanence, does it give something meaningful?
I think Nima has something on that,
no,
right?
No. They proved that my root of 2 to the power n conjecture, which I had in that 11 paper, that was proved.
Right. But I think it's some version of this variational principle, which is not exactly belief propagation, but some other variational principle, right? Am I right?
So e to the n you can prove for more general than permanence.
Right. Yeah, but I have kind of historical remark, which was quite fascinating for this community. So that the first application of the lower bound on beta approximation was actually monomer dimer problem. That was really cool thing, and I thought I thought, wow, it's so cool that you have this thing from physics. With a little bit of massaging, you go back to physics, and I thought that the physics is so powerful. Fortunately or unfortunately, it happened to be that you could do the same thing even better using my original method, which I did not see at the time. And people knew about better. People who worked on monomer dimer, they knew about better approximation. They did not see.
Well, actually, Lenny, I should probably take it back in terms of upper bound. There is this maximum likelihood version of beta free energy. Well, what physicists would call zero temperature. In this case, what we are getting for beta free energy optimization is basically linear programming. We call it LPBP. And it's actually, so it's a minimization for minus log, object which you are studying is minus logarithm of partition function. And it's low bound, so it's relaxation of exact polytope. And you can elevate it to some temperatures, and it's not clear how far, but that will certainly give you upper bound. How accurate it is, well, that's probably much looser than what Nima suggested, but that's at least one. People just didn't focus on that much. at least in this graphical model community or statistical physics community, as far as I know.
So this three-weighted EP, that's something that always gives you an upper bound, right?
That's true too. Yes, that's right. That's right. So it's Martin Wainwright's story. So three-weighted BP, which is another version of this belief propagation, but kind of specialized. Yes.
True.
Yeah. So there are some stories. Yeah.
Anybody else? Okay. Thanks again.